me.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord, May 2nd, 2017. Lord, we thank you that you are active in the lives of your people. Father, we thank you for his place and the opportunity that we have tonight here, Lord, to open up your word and to learn of you. Father, it's my prayer that you would help us to put aside the concerns of the day and to focus on you, Lord, and what you have for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Things that we do for folks that are new, again, is we like to get to know each other. And there's various different ways to do that. The way that we have chosen here to do it, besides just the mingling that we do here and there, is give testimonies. And so tonight, Eddie is going to give his
testimony.
Hey! Tonight, I'll give a brief testimony. We'll have a list and you can sign up and you'll have time to prepare and all that. And it's certainly not mandatory by any stretch, but it gives us a chance to get to know each other a little bit better, where we come from, and some of the things that God has done in our lives. And there's a couple of different patterns that people use for testimonies. And I'm kind of refining it. I was working with Anthony the other day, but I didn't take notes, so I don't have that part. So the pattern that we use is like what Paul did in the book of Acts. He basically said, this is who I was prior. This is how I became a believer. This is what happened. And that was when he got apprehended on the road to Damascus. And then this is who I am now. And so who I was born in Santa Ana. And early on, my parents divorced. I think I was 4 when they divorced. My mother was a hippie, and she left to go be a hippie. And so she moved to San Francisco and traveled all around and went to New York and Woodstock and all the fun stuff that people did back then while we were without mom for a period of time. And I struggled socially growing up. I was skinny, had big ears, and didn't like much about myself. And at about age 12, I started drinking fairly heavily. I'd been drinking probably since I was 6. My dad would allow us to drink, right? He'd say, you know, we'd get him a beer and we'd be able to take one, right? So, you know, as the night wore on and he got more and more drunk, we could take more out of it without him noticing. And so I was used to it, but by the time I was 12, we were getting it on our own and drinking. And by the time I turned 13, my mom re-entered my life, and the world of drugs were opened up to me. My mom is the one who first smoked marijuana with me. She's the one who taught me about cocaine and all these things. And the drugs helped me and the alcohol to be at ease. I felt more comfortable in social environments, and I began to take on a role in the social environments. I wasn't just Bob. I would be Bob the stoner, or, you know, Bob the badass, at least that's what I thought at that time. And I lived the life of playing a role for a long period of time. And I was real self-conscious of who I was, and I struggled with it. Fast forward, I joined the Navy, married my high school sweetheart, joined the Navy. Used drugs in the Navy, was sneaky enough about it, and I got away with it for the most part. Got out of the Navy, and I had no longer had that controlling factor of the Navy. I had to kind of live with my drug use. Out of the Navy, and I remember the night I got out, bought a quarter ounce of coke, some amount of weed, and, you know, all this alcohol, and that was my part. somehow I managed to be successful at various different points. I mean, I didn't graduate high school. I got kicked out of school. I went to 5 different high schools, and I got kicked out of most of them. And the last one was Gilbert High School. It was a continuation school in Anaheim. I got kicked out of there. But in other areas, I was successful to some level, and I was successful at work, and I got a fairly good job, was making good money, but I was still involved in drugs the whole way through. And my ex-wife hated drugs with a passion, so we had that tension between us. And through work, I started using. I'd used heroin in high school. I'd used it a couple of times in the Navy, but now that I was out, I started using it again after just a couple of years of being out. And within just a short period of time, I was a raging heroin addict, and I actually quit my job and moved away from my family. They didn't throw me out. I moved away because I didn't have enough time to get high, right? I didn't want to have to hide my drug abuse. I just wanted to be free to do it on my own, so I left everything. And I sold, I had my own business on the side. I sold all the equipment from my business and various things to do with the business to support my drug addiction. And I burned everybody that I came in contact with. I stole from the people that I loved. Stole from people that I didn't know. I stole from everybody. Because after I got done selling my stuff, I started selling your stuff, right, to maintain my addiction. And I've always been a sensitive person. I'm not really a tough guy. I'm more of a sensitive type of person. And it seemed that everybody that I hurt them, but it hurt me as well. And I got to a point where I just hurt. And all I would do the drugs for then was just to try and cover up the pain. And I was trying to get saved. I was going to church, living in my truck. And I'd go to church on Sunday morning. You know, I'd sit in the back and hadn't taken a shower for 2 or 3 weeks, so I'd stay and people would look at me weird. But I'd sit in the back of the church and listen to the message, and then I'd take off before it was over so nobody, you know, try to apprehend me and change the way I was living. I remember one day I went to pick up to buy drugs, and a guy got in my truck, and my Bible was on the dashboard of my truck, and he's like, "That's yours?" I'm like, "Yeah." He goes, "What's this?" I'm like, I'm trying to figure it out. I'm just trying to figure it out. So I came to a point one night that I couldn't take it anymore. I was laying on the seat of my truck and I was thinking of how I could kill myself in such a way that it wouldn't disgrace my family. And I just had a moment of clarity and I thought, what the heck am I doing? And I cried out to God and I said, "Lord, if you're real, for me, the worst thing on the planet was to go to jail." And so I threw that in there. Even if I got to go to jail, I need to change. I can't take another day of this. That was about 3 o'clock in the morning. 10 o'clock that night, I got arrested. The cops pulled me over, and they said, "Hey, there's a report of somebody in the area in a gray truck waving a gun out the window." I'm like, "I don't have a gun. Well, can we search your vehicle?" I started to tell them my little game that I would do, you know, "Oh, you can't do this and that." Then I remembered my prayer. And I said, "Yeah, you can search my vehicle. You're not going to find a gun. But if you pop the door panel loose on the driver's side, you're going to find heroin and cocaine, and you're going to find syringes and paraphernalia." They're like, "Really?" I'm like, "Yeah." So they went, "Yeah, he was right. It's there." Then they came back, "Oh, we found these bullets under the seat. There is a gun." "Dude, there's not a gun. I sold my gun a long time ago. Hey, I need to get high, so I gave that up as well." They took me to jail. The judge sent me to Teen Challenge. He said, "You have a choice. You can go to Chino for 2 years, or you can go to Teen Challenge for a year." I said, "What is this Teen Challenge?" He said, "It's a drug rehab program." And I said, "I've been in 6 different drug rehab programs already this year. It's not going to work." And he goes, "This one's different. Give it a try." And I did. And it was different. Because they taught me about Jesus. And that's all they did. It was Jesus 24/7. And I was finally free. be healthy, because I will let things go. I'll be running late because I spent too much time reading. You know, I do that, but it's certainly not where it's destructive to my life and destructive to others. And God has changed everything. He rebuilt my life. When I got out of Teen Challenge, I started $5 an hour. The last job I had was $18 an hour. It was like 1990, so it was pretty good money for then. Started out at $5 an hour, and I saved my money, and I bought a bicycle. Had a bigger area of influence, had a better job, saved that money, bought a car, got a better job, and it just on and on and on. And God's kept me on a short leash. You know, He hasn't given me a whole bunch at one time, but I'm married. My kids that were from my first marriage, they respect me. I'm in their life. They actually came to live with me when they were still children because they respected me. Instead of the old dad, I was the new dad. And I had taken the kids with me to buy drugs. You know, when they were like, my daughter was 6 and my son was 2. You know, what kind of craziness was that? But I got that back. God has restored my life. And people, I get respect. You know, not that that's what life is all about, but I don't sit next to somebody and they grab their purse and pull it next to me. I don't look at people as, what can I get from them? I look at people, what can I give to them? I'm a positive influence instead of a drain on society. And I can sleep at night. God is good to me. He is. He's taught me His word. He's given me opportunity beyond opportunity. And I love being a Christian. I absolutely love it. And I have the hope of heaven. I have the hope of living in the kingdom of God on the other side and having a new body. My body is messed up. I've done so many things, my neck, my back, my shoulders, my knees. They're a disaster. And I'm getting a new body. Yeah. God bless. So that's a little bit about me. Also, when Carol gets here, we'll have a list with the dates, and you can sign up if you'd like to give your testimony. So, Romans chapter 1. The New Testament has, the first 5 books are the Gospels and the books of history. The history of who Jesus was and His mission here. And then the history of the early church, the book of Acts. We just finished up the book of Acts. And now we enter into the section of the New Testament called the Epistles. And an epistle is a fancy word for a letter. So these are just letters that were written by certain men to a group of people. Typically, they were written to churches. The book of Romans is written by the Apostle Paul to people in Rome. It wasn't written to a specific church in Rome, but to the house churches and the various different believers there. Paul, at this point, had never visited Rome. He did visit Rome before the end of his life, but he had a great desire to visit Rome. The Apostle Paul was raised early on in Cilicia, in Tarsus of Cilicia, which was a very important city, a city of education and culture, on par with Athens and Alexandria, the other two big cities of education and culture of that time. And Paul was a Jew, and his father, and quite possibly his grandfather, were of a sect of the Jews called the Pharisees. The Pharisees were a group of religious zealots. It was their intent to do it right. And when the Pharisees, the very beginning of the Pharisaic movement goes all the way back to the book of Ezra. And the plan and the purpose they had was good. But through the years, it became And that's basically what religion is about, according to the Pharisees. And we've learned through Christianity that our religion is faith and a relationship with God. They had missed out on the relationship part. They got some of the obedience part, but they took it to the nth degree. And they overlooked how they treated their fellow man. And to them, it was all about that list. They could go down the list on the left, I haven't done these things. Go down the list on the right, I've done these things. And they would go to bed feeling good about themselves. That was the history, the lineage that Paul came from. So Paul, in his zeal for God, at one point began to persecute the early church. And we studied that as we studied the book of Acts over the last couple of months. He being this Pharisee, Pharisees were one of the main groups that opposed Jesus, as we read the Gospels. Paul opposed the Christians to the point where he would hunt them down, and under the authority of the church, he could arrest them and bring them to trial, and they were beaten. Some were stoned to death. Some were simply imprisoned and released with threats. But that was the Apostle Paul. As he is traveling one day on his mission to Damascus to gather up more Christians and bring them back to persecute, the Lord Jesus apprehended him. And we can read about that in Acts chapter 9, where he's traveling along and a light from heaven shines about him and startles him with a loud voice, and it knocks him off his horse. And Jesus says to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" He was known as Saul at this point. And Saul says, "Well, who are you that I'm persecuting?" And the Lord says to him, "I'm Jesus whom you are persecuting. Now get up and go into the city, and it will be told what you must do." And he does. He gets up. He's blind for 3 days. So God gives him 3 days to think about things. And when Paul, a Christian man, the Lord tells him, "You go and pray for Paul." He does. Paul regains his sight, and from that point on, Paul is a Christian, and he understands that this Messiah, Jesus, was right, and his life becomes about telling people the good news that we can have peace with God through the grace provided through Christ Jesus. Paul, at this point, like I said, had not visited Rome. And so he didn't know exactly what they were taught. And we benefit greatly from that, because he gives the most comprehensive explanation of the gospel message in the book of Romans. And it is the most detailed message of all of the New Testament. I'm going to read just the first sentence of the introduction here. It says, Coleridge, I'm not sure who he was, called Paul's letter to the Romans, quote, "the most profound work in existence." Many see this as that. There were secular people that said that this was one of the most profound pieces of literature of all time. And we have the opportunity over the next weeks and months to study this and to learn the gospel from the inside out. Without further ado, I will read, and as my pattern is, we will read a portion of Scripture, and then we're going to walk back through those verses, and we're going to discuss what they mean. So, we're going to read Romans chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. And I read and teach from the New American Standard Bible. It says, "Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord." Verse 5. "Through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for his name's sake, among whom you also are the call of Jesus Christ. To all who are beloved of God in Rome, called as saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Letters in this day are not like the letters we have now. Nowadays, we write to so-and-so, or dear John, and then at the end, love, Sally. They would, at the beginning of their letter, they would say who they're writing, they would introduce themselves and their audience at the very beginning of the letter. And that's how all the New Testament letters start out, is with an introduction and tells us who the writer is, with the exception of the book of Hebrews. So Paul starts this letter, Paul, a bondservant of Christ Jesus, called as an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. So Paul first identifies himself as a bondservant. Your translation may say a slave. Paul saw himself as being owned by God. The time period that this is written, roughly half, possibly more, of the population of the Roman Empire were slaves. So many could identify to what it meant to be a slave. And a slave is basically one who is consumed with the will of their master. You want to please your master? Do what his will is. Do what he wants done. You're not concerned with your own self. You take care of him. And that's what Paul saw himself as. Further, this term, doulos, the term in the Greek, and I'll explain a lot of how I teach as I go along when things come up. I don't know Greek, but I have a Greek dictionary. And so from time to time, I'll say those things. So the word doulos, which is the term translated bondservant here, is a slave by choice. So there was slaves who had been born into slavery. You could be a slave in that way. You could be a slave by having your nation be conquered by Rome. If Rome came and conquered your nation, they might take a number of the middle-aged people, or the young men and young women and healthy, and bring them back and use them as slaves in their community. You could also be an indentured servant. So if you got yourself in debt, you could pay off your debt by being a slave. So if you owed somebody, say you were buying a house and you got behind on your mortgage and said, you know what, how about we just knock this out in 7 years, I'm going to be your slave for the next 7 years, and at the end of that time I'm free. Fair enough. So that now your slave owner provides for you entirely. He provides your food, he provides your clothing, your place to live, everything. But all you do is what he wants you to do. So they had, in the Old Testament, it talks about the process of becoming a bondservant. The change from being a slave to a slave by choice. Now you think, why would somebody be a slave by choice? That doesn't sound like a choice that I would make. Well, generally it would happen in this way. So maybe I was an indentured servant, and in my time I met a young lady, and she was owned by the same master, and she was born a slave into that home. And my master allowed me to marry her, and we have children. Now, if I'm free, I'm going to go and live and do things elsewhere, right? But I love my wife and my children. Or maybe none of that has happened. I just love my master. He's treated me well. Life is good. I may be a slave, but life is good. You know, I got a nice car, and got a motorcycle, or whatever they, you know, would have back then, and I'm enjoying life. You could become a willing slave. And what they would do to indicate that they were a slave by choice is they would take them over to the doorpost, and they would put their ear up against the post, and they would drive an awl through their earlobe. They would put a gold ring in it. And so those that were doulos slaves had a gold ring in their ear. And so Paul sees himself, he announces himself as two things here, a slave and an apostle. But he and word order and the order of things is important in literature, so that we would see the slave as more important than the fact that he was an apostle. An apostle, he says he is called as an apostle. the thought of being called is that, like when Jesus said to his disciples, you didn't choose me, I chose you. So there's that calling, and that's the same as us. We think, well, like I think, well, I was laying in my truck, and I called out to God. Yeah, he was orchestrating events in my life to cause me to come to him. Now, was he selling me heroin and causing bad things? Absolutely not. But does he control everything, and is he using evil to do his will? He does. He uses the devil to do his will. The devil thinks he's got all this and all that, but he's just an errand boy for the Lord. You know, doing what God wants him to do to bring people to him at certain times. He does his own evil stuff as well, but God certainly uses him. So, called as an apostle. Now, an apostle, that term means someone who is sent with authority. So these apostles were commissioned by Jesus. We have the 12 initially, and then one, the son of perdition, went off and hung himself, right? What was his name? Judas. Judas Iscariot, right? And so now the 12 became the 11, and Peter stood up in the midst of the congregation and said, we're supposed to be the 12. We got to have one more. So they went through a process of election, and they appointed another one. But we don't read of anything really happening with him. And whether he was in God's will doing that or not, the Bible doesn't say. But it does say that God chose the 12th one as well. And the one that he chose is the Apostle Paul. And so Paul is an apostle, one who is sent. We have those who are sent today. We call them missionaries. Right? They go in and they preach the good news, and they teach God's word in foreign countries and various different places. The difference between these apostles and the missionaries today is in that authority. There is nobody on the earth today that has the authority that the apostles have. These apostles, like the Old Testament prophets, had the authority to speak the word of God. Paul wrote this letter as moved by the Holy Spirit, and this is the word of God. They could say, thus saith the Lord, as it would say in the King James. And this is God speaking to you, and they would prophesy, they would tell you something that is coming from God. And that has the same power as the scripture did. We don't have people on the planet today that have that power. We have apostles, in the sense that we have those sent, but not with that same authority. So Paul, a bondservant and an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, set apart from regular life. He's no longer doing life as he did before. He's been set apart. And the term set apart is also used and translated holy in other places. And what comes to my mind were the utensils that were used in the tabernacle and in the temple of God. There were gold vessels that were used for certain things. There was a gold lampstand. These things were made. They were consecrated to the Lord. They went through a process of consecration, which from that point on, they were set apart for a purpose. And it's the same with us. We've been set apart, like Paul, for a purpose. We've been made holy. And you may not look at yourself as, hey, I'm Holy Jim or Holy Bob or Holy Leslie. We are. God has cleaned us up, and he has set us apart for a purpose. So Paul was set apart, and sometimes there's interesting wordplay, and we don't necessarily see it in the English, but the term Pharisee, the root word for Pharisee meant that they were set apart. So that, in the Greek, this is the same root as Pharisee. So he was set apart as a Pharisee. Now he is set apart from the gospel of God. But what is the gospel of God? The gospel of God, that term gospel, simply means good news. Right? We turn on the news today, we rarely get good news. Right? We usually get there was a hit and run over here, and there was a shooting over here, and maybe this politician died, had a heart attack. Every once in a while there's a story of good news. You know, they talk about some philanthropic organization that's helping the poor.
For about 3 seconds.
Something to that effect. But generally speaking, the news that we see now is bad news. Because Because if they tell good news, they don't have an audience. But this is good news, and that good news is that we can have a right standing with God, our Creator. We have an opportunity through faith in the work of His Son to enter into the presence of God. The Jews thought they sought that presence of God through the religious practices they were given in the Old Testament. All of those, the New Testament tells us, were simply a shadow of the things to come. So the tabernacle, the furniture within it, all of those were symbolic of things in the New Testament, things that Christ fulfilled. Right? The sacrificial lamb. Do you remember? Does anybody remember what John the Baptist called Jesus when he saw him the first time? The Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. So even that sacrificial lamb that they would sacrifice was symbolic of Jesus. So the Jews sought that relationship, that right standing with God through those practices, not understanding that those practices were simply to show them of the Messiah who was coming. So set apart from the gospel, we're going to have to pick up the pace for verse 1. Which he promised beforehand through his... See, my wife's not here. She'll tell me. You're on track. You're in verse 1. You've been in it for 25 minutes. We'll move on quicker here. So, the gospel which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. So, the Old Testament has prophecy after prophecy after prophecy foretelling of the coming of the Messiah. We're going to take a quick look at the very first prophecy. And... it's in Genesis, either in chapter 1 or chapter 2. Let's see. No, it's in chapter 3. All right, so in Genesis chapter 3, God, Adam and Eve have eaten the forbidden fruit. God is confronting them. God has cursed the serpent. And at the end of his serpent here, let's see. Oh, come on, I actually wrote this down. 3:15. Thank you. So the very first prophecy, thank you, dear. The very first prophecy that we have is right in the third chapter of Genesis, where God says, I will put enmity between you, he's speaking to Satan, and the woman, between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise him on the heel. So that is looked at as the very first prophecy of one who will overcome Satan and ultimately redeem not only mankind, but all of creation from the fall, from the things that have taken place. And then the rest of the Old Testament, there is prophecy after prophecy speaking. Those are the things that were promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. Verse 3, concerning his son, that is Jesus, and in verses 3 and 4, I'll read those, his son, who was born of a descendant of David according to the flesh, and who was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead, according to the Spirit of holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord. So in verses 3 and 4, we see this, what is in the theological term is called theos anthropos, the God-man. In verse 3, it shows that Jesus was a man. In verse 4, he is God. Jesus was God and man. He was fully God and fully man from the time he was conceived. Ongoing. He's still a man in heaven. And he never gave up being God, but the scripture tells us that he gave up the prerogative of God. So he became hungry. He was lonely. If he stubbed his toe, it hurt. Right? He had humanity, and he gave up the prerogative of God. So fully man, as he was a descendant of David. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, we're not going to go there because I wasted I didn't waste, but I used too much time on verse 1. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, King David wants to build a house for God. He's laying one night in his old palace and says, here I have this great palace of cedar-lined walls and gold everywhere, and the ark of God is in a tent. And it convicts him. He says, I'm going to. So he calls his prophet in. He calls in Nathan. He says, Nathan, I'm going to build a house for God. I'm going to build a temple. Nathan says to him, do all that your heart desires. So David goes back to bed. Nathan goes back to bed. God says, hey, Nathan, you should have checked with me on that. I want David building a house for me. Okay? He's been in too many battles. He's killed too many men. He's not the guy for this. So Nathan has to go back and tell King David, I kind of spoke out of turn. You're not going to do that. But what God tells him is this. I'm going to honor that desire that you had for me. You wanted to build me a house? I'm going to build you a house. And he's not talking about a physical house. He's talking about a family. And he gives David the promise that the Messiah will come from his lineage. And he does. So the temple gets built by David's son Solomon. And then through the line of David, through man after man after man, comes down and Jesus is born. And he's related to King David. So he is the lineage of the king. So that is the part there. It says he's a descendant of David according to the flesh, according to the body. With the New Testament, it uses the term flesh. Sometimes it just means our body, and sometimes it means our nature, our sinful nature. This just means his body. And then, so he was declared the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. So the miracles that Jesus did confirmed the things that he said. One of the times that that was very clear is when there was a man, Jesus said to him, your sins are forgiven. And those around were thinking to themselves, who is this that says he could forgive sins? And Jesus knew what they were thinking. It's God. And he says to them, tell me this, which is easier? To say to that guy, your sins are forgiven? Or to say, pick up your mat and walk to this crippled man? So obviously to say your sins are forgiven, because how would anybody know if it was done or not, right? So he says, so that you will know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he said to the crippled man, pick up your mat and walk. And the crippled man got up, rolled up his mat, and walked out the door. And everybody said, ooh. So the miracles that he did confirmed the things that he said. The ultimate miracle confirmed the ultimate thing that he said. And that was that he was the Son of God. And the ultimate miracle was him rising from the dead. So according to the Spirit of Holiness, Jesus Christ our Lord, the term there, Spirit of Holiness, is just a Hebraic way of saying the Holy Spirit. Jesus Christ our Lord, the whole part of that, the Lord Jesus Christ, is not his name. His name is Jesus. Jesus means, it's the name of God, Jehovah or Yahweh. Not sure how to pronounce that, but we'll say Jehovah for lack of anything else. Jehovah is salvation, or Yahweh is salvation. That's what Jesus means. Lord was used in the Old Testament. The Jews did not want to say the name of God, that Yahweh. They were afraid to say it. So they used the word Lord in place of that. Every time in Scripture, instead of having his name there, they would use the word Lord. And also, the New Testament, the same word, Lord, is used for sir. So sometimes it's just an honorable term, right? Hello, sir, then hello, Lord. Like when Paul was interrupted on the road to Damascus, he said, who are you, Lord? When Jesus was interrupting him, he wasn't necessarily recognizing him as Jesus, because he was saying, who are you? It's more like just a term of respect. Who are you, sir? Christ. Christ is the Greek of the Hebrew Messiah. And that term means the anointed one. And the anointing, if we were to go back into the Old Testament, we would see, like with Aaron the priest, when Aaron was consecrated and became the priest, they poured olive oil over his head. Anointing means to rub. pour it on, and then they would rub it on it. So that's what anointing means. So the anointed one was the one who had the oil poured on him. When King David, when Samuel found David and prophesied that he is going to be the next king of Israel, he took out his flask of oil and he poured it on David's head. He anointed him with oil. At that point, David was the Messiah. Not the Messiah, Jesus, but in the sense that he was the anointed one. So these terms have different meanings. The context helps us to determine the meaning. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Yeah, we're doing good. We're back on track. Because I don't really plan to get through half. To explain a little bit more, I'm going to do this probably for a couple of weeks. Generally speaking, we do a chapter a night. Okay? For the book of Romans, my goal is to do a half a chapter a night, because we're going to have, this is pretty heavy theology. What I don't want to do is get bogged down and do three verses a night. You have my promise. We're not going to do that. My wife will be here to get stink eye if I get too slow and too slow. Trust me. She does. She'll get like, move on, buddy. All right. So verse 5. Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for his name's sake. So Paul and those who were with him had this grace. God had given them the grace to be an apostle and had given them the authority and the commission to go out and preach his word. And it was for his name, for the name of our King, Jesus Christ. And we've already covered the term apostle, and we're not going to get stuck on that. And faith, we're going to deal with as we go further. But I'll just stop real briefly and say, an easy way to look at faith is trusting in the trustworthiness of God. That's a simple explanation of faith. I like to take these difficult terms and bring them down to a level that I can understand. Because I'll read this thing in, six paragraphs about something in one of the dictionaries, and then I'll go to another one and it'll go, trusting in the trustworthiness of God. Oh, that's the one I want right here. Yeah. Right? So those are the ones that I'll be bringing as much as possible. So verse 6, among whom you also are the called according to Jesus Christ. And being called, again, being chosen. This one I think is worth looking at. We're going to take a field trip over to Ephesians chapter 1. So that's going to be to the right, a couple of books. Ephesians chapter 1, and we're going to look at verses 4 through 11. Give everybody an opportunity to get there. All right. So we're looking at the term called. We also see that as chosen. So verse 4 of Ephesians 1. Just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us to the adoption as sons through Jesus Christ to himself, according to the kind intention of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, which he freely bestowed on us in the beloved. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight. He made known to us the mystery of his will according to his kind intention, which he purposed in him, with a view to an administration suitable to the fullness of times, that is, the summing up of all things in Christ, things in heaven and things on earth, in him. In him also we have obtained an inheritance, well, like that, having been predestined according to his purpose, who works all things after the counsel of his will. So the main points we want to take out of there is predestined according to his purpose, and from verse 4, he chose us in him before the foundation of the world. And as one pastor that I heard said, it's a good thing he chose me before the foundation of the world, because if he'd have commentaries, dictionaries, various different things. I listen to various different pastors. So you may hear me quote something. You go, boy, I've heard that before. It's because I've heard it before, and I bring it to you. So I want you to know I'm not some great scholar, although I'm not reading from notes. I'm reading, and the notes are in my mind. But these are things that if you would ask me 3 weeks ago, I didn't know these. I just recently studied them. Just wanted transparency. I'm not some great scholar. I just study, and I bring it to share. Okay? So, verse 7, to all who are beloved in God in Rome, called as saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So God calls us, through the Apostle Paul, and all believers, saints. And the Roman Catholic Church has a concept of a saint, and they have to be somebody and do certain things. And Jesus Christ has a concept of a saint, and we've got to be somebody and do certain things. For us to be a saint, we have to believe in Jesus Christ. We have to turn from our wicked ways and pursue a life in Him. And we do that, there's a number of things they call us. They call us Christians, they call us believers, followers of Jesus, or a saint. So we can look at this as Saint Gabriel, right? Saint Eric. You probably want to call me Saint Robert, because Saint Bob sounds kind of saints. Alright, so verse, now we're going to take a look. Let's see, we'll go ahead and read verses 8 through 16, and I think we can get through that before 8:30. So, first, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for you all, because your faith is being proclaimed throughout the whole world. For God, whom I serve in my spirit in the preaching of the gospel of his Son, is my witness as to how unceasingly I make mention of you, always in my prayers, making requests, if perhaps now, at last, by the will of God, I may succeed in coming to you. Verse 11. For I long to see you in order that I may impart some spiritual gift to you, that you may be established, that is, that I may be encouraged together with you, while among you, each of us by each other's faith, both yours and mine. And I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that often I have planned to come to you, and having been prevented thus far, in order that I might obtain some fruit among you also, even as among the rest of the Gentiles. Excuse me. Verse 14. I am under obligation, both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. Thus, for my part, I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. And we'll stop there. So, Paul, now, this is the longest introduction of any of the epistles, right? We don't get through the introduction until we get to verse 16. Verses 1 through 15 are all high. It's like, you know, Dear John, right? That's the Dear John part. It's all the way to verse 15. So now he reminds them here, he brings to their knowledge the fact that their faith is proclaimed in all the world. Now, it's not all the world. This is the preachers of all the world. This is the known world. This is the Greek world. Everywhere where Paul went, basically, people were saying, he would say, I'm going to go here and preach the gospel because nobody has preached yet. And he'd say, I desire to go to Rome. And they go, well, there's already Christians in Rome. There's already believers. Everywhere he went, people were saying, yes, there are believers in Rome already. And so they were speaking the fact that these people had faith already. And we don't know how the church in Rome was founded. There is nothing in Scripture or secular history that says absolutely how it was founded. We have some ideas. Catholic tradition is what?
Peter.
There is nothing that speaks of Peter founding the church. In fact, there's kind of some evidence pointing that he didn't found the church. Most likely, if we were to go back into Acts chapter 2, on the day of Pentecost, we won't go there, but on the day of Pentecost, when that great sound of a mighty rushing wind came in, and the fire came down, and there were tongues of fire on the people's heads, and they were speaking in tongues, it said all the people in Jerusalem came running to this area. Now, at this time, Pentecost and Passover are the two of the three great feasts that the people were required, the Jewish men were required to attend, if possible, every year. So these are the times when Jerusalem would be abundant with people coming from other areas. And it says, in that time when they were hearing this event take place, they mentioned all these various different cities, and it says, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes. And so these people all get together, they're hearing this, they come rushing in. Peter takes advantage of that big audience, and he preaches the very first gospel message. Most likely, these people then, after the feast, they go back home, right? And they start telling, hey, the Messiah has come, and this is what happened. So that is probably, most of the people that I've read believe that that is how the church of Rome started. Not, there is no evidence that any of the apostles started it. So their faith was being proclaimed throughout the whole world. Verse 9, for God whom I serve in my spirit in preaching the gospel is my witness as to how unceasingly I make mention of you always in my prayers. So Paul is calling God as his witness to say, hey, even God could witness how much I pray for you guys. I don't even know you yet. Your believers, and Paul was a man of prayer. If you want to be great in God's kingdom, pray. Pray for people. God will use you. Pray for the things that you want to do in God's kingdom, and He will use you. Paul prayed for these people, and ultimately he did. He was able to see them. And he didn't even have to pay for his trip to Rome. He was paid for by the government. Wasn't first-class carriage. he was chained to a soldier. But he did get to go to Rome free of charge. So he says he prays for them. Verse 11, for I long to see you in order that I may impart some spiritual gift to you, that you may be established, that is, that they would be built up. Verse 12, that is, that I may be encouraged together with you while among you, each of us, by each other's faith, both yours and mine. So Paul desired to go to them to impart to them some spiritual gift. He wanted to teach them these things. He didn't know if he was going to get to them, so he writes them down, but he wants to go and teach them the Word of God. And that's the gift that he wants to share with them. And also, Paul wants to be encouraged by their faith. He wants to encourage them with his faith. But even the great apostle Paul needed encouragement. He needed community. He needed other believers, just like we do. That is one of the things that we have unique here at his place, is we have a strong community of believers. We get to know each other. And it is my prayer that this group, as we go through the book of Romans, we will get to know each other. We don't get to know each other sitting here studying. We get to know each other when we show up just a few minutes early. We get to know each other when we have our little snacks and we chat, and then after we see each other out and about the church, we go, hey, I saw you in the Bible study. And we begin to get to know one another. Paul needed that community, and so did we. So, verse 13, and I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I often had planned to come to you and have been prevented thus far, in order that I may obtain some fruit among you also, even as the rest of the Gentiles. Paul said that he did not want to build on another man's foundation. So, if he was following his own pattern, he would not go to Rome until he had basically evangelized the known world, the world in which he was aware of. And he pretty much had done so. He hadn't gone down to Egypt and down to that area. There were other apostles that had gone down south, but Paul had done all of the Western Asia at that time, and then he had made his way into Greece and then some of the islands along there. And so he had, if he were to go to Rome and not having done those other things, he would be building on another man's foundation. So that's one of the things that would have stopped him, is his very own honor or whatever. He said that he didn't want to build on somebody else's foundation. But now he says, I don't want to build, but there's somebody else has already built that foundation, but he is going to go and build on it. He's not going to build a new church. He's going to strengthen them by giving them the word of God. So, verse 14, I am under obligation to Greeks and to barbarians, both to wise and to the foolish. So Paul had a great sense of responsibility with his calling. He said he saw himself as under obligation to the Greeks and barbarians. The Greeks saw anybody who didn't speak Greek as a barbarian. And it didn't have the same connotation that it does now. Somebody who is, wild, you know, uncultured. They were people that they were uncultured, but not, I don't know what the right term would be. But we have the sense of a barbarian is somebody saying, you know, they don't know, they're like an unknown tribe, right? They never know anything about any other society. The Greeks saw people that didn't speak Greek as barbarian because they thought the way they spoke, they sounded like bar, 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 bar. They couldn't understand their language, so they came up with a term bar, and they called them barbarians, right? If you didn't speak our language, you were a barbarian. But it wasn't necessarily that they were wild animals in that respect. So Paul was under obligation to both the Greeks, we'll say those who speak Greek and those who don't, both to the wise and to the foolish. See, he includes some of us in there. You can determine yourself whether you're the wise or the foolish. Thus, for my part, I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. So Paul, although they had established their church there, Paul wanted to come and he was going to preach and to teach, and they are definitely different. Preaching is what we do on Sunday morning when we have non-believers or people like that in our congregation. Teaching is what we do here on Tuesday nights. And with that, should we take on Brian Dunshane?
Wrong verse 2.
You're in trouble now?
Verse 2.
I feel like I believe it.
You know what? We have got 12 minutes. I think we're going to tackle those next two verses. Oh, we got 15 even.
Yes.
All right, so verses 16 and 17. Now we come to the theme of the book of Romans. Verses 16 and 17. And that's as far as we're going, Miss Carol. We're not planning to try. I told him where you were. All right, so verses 16 and 17 of Romans chapter 1. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. So like I said, this is the theme of the entire book, the gospel, the power of God to change lives. He says, I am not ashamed of the gospel. We have to wonder, well, what would there be to be ashamed of? Right? But look how we are in our society. I know when I was young and was introduced to Christianity and thought, I'll be a Christian, then I get around all my old stoner friends, it's like, no, I had to, no, I'm not one of those guys. I was kind of like Peter. I don't know the man, right? Denying it. But there were, to the Romans, to the Greeks, and those societies, the gospel message was foolishness. They didn't believe in resurrection. They didn't believe in afterlife in this respect. So they saw it as complete foolishness. And to the Jews, they were looking for a Messiah who was a strong king, who would come in and militarily destroy the other nations and bring Israel back to domination over society and do it by military might. And to them, a Messiah that was taken by the enemy and crucified was humiliating. So to the Jews, not embrace, you know, the hardcore Jew had a lot to overcome to embrace the gospel. So Paul says, despite all of that, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. You might look at it as foolishness, or you might be stumbled over the fact that the Messiah was murdered by the enemy, by the Romans, quote unquote, the enemy. But I'm not ashamed. Why is that? Well, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek or to the Gentile, to the non-Jew. It is the power of God for salvation. The Old Testament view of salvation was being saved in the here and now, being saved from calamity in life, being saved from difficult things. And like we would now get into a difficult situation and say, Lord, save me from this issue, help me in this. The New Testament thought of salvation is ultimate salvation. Salvation will be joined God for eternity in heaven. This, in this passage, encompasses both of those. The gospel message is both for the salvation in the here and now, to help us as we live this life now amongst the world and the things that we face on a daily basis, but more so then also salvation for eternity, saving us from the wrath of God. And we're going to see God's wrath as we look at the next couple of chapters, as Paul tells us about why we need salvation. People might go, well, that's okay for you, but I don't really need that. I'm kind of a good guy. I got the look up, right? He's going to make that very clear. So the power of God for salvation to everyone, see, not just to the Jew. He's the Jewish Messiah, but he didn't come only for the Jews. To everyone, and here is the condition. Right? We say that God's grace is unconditional. God's love is unconditional. There's one condition to receive that. That's belief. Trusting in the trustworthiness of God. So the same term in the Greek is translated faith, it's translated belief, and it's translated trust in different places. So trusting in the trustworthiness of God. Faith is required. That's the one condition that God has placed on us. To the Jew first, and also to the non-Jew. Why to the Jew first? Because God promised it to them, and he brought the Messiah through them. Does that place them better than us? No. Jesus came to the Jews first. They have the exact same requirement for salvation. Although they don't necessarily, many of the Jews don't necessarily believe that or understand that. The Bible is clear that all have sinned. Paul's going to tell us that here. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father. He didn't say, no one who's not a Jew, right? Or no one who, no one comes to the Father except in the gospel message of Jesus dying on the cross, according to the scriptures, being buried and raised on the third day. That's the basis of the gospel message. 1 Corinthians 15:3 and 4. For in it, the righteousness of God is revealed. The righteousness of God is revealed. Not that we see God's righteousness, but it's revealed in that it's made available to us. There is a righteousness for us that allows us to be in his presence. How's that happen? It happens by belief in God. By belief in the work that Christ has done, our sins are washed away, and the righteousness of God is attributed to us by faith. Genesis 15:6. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Before the law was ever given, righteousness was by faith. It's always been by faith. Never was it according to a sacrifice of an animal. Never was it by ritual. It had always been by faith. The Jew Jews got off track. They didn't see that. So for in it, that is the gospel, the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. So it starts in faith and it ends in faith. You begin with faith and you build in faith. As it is written, but the righteous man shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. That term righteous is also translated just. So here's basically the just shall live, whereas the righteous shall live. It means the same basic thing. That should be Habakkuk 2:4, I believe. Let me see, 17. Yeah, Habakkuk 2:4 says, the righteous shall live by faith. See, there's a number of verses in the Old Testament that clearly say, like with Abraham, Abraham believed God and it was credited to him as righteous. Not because of what he did, but because he believed God. He trusted in the trustworthiness of God. And Habakkuk 2:4, the righteous shall live by faith. And there's kind of a trilogy of three books in the New Testament. There is Romans, Ephesians, and Hebrews. The just shall live by faith. Romans tells us about the just. The righteousness of God is revealed. Shall live. Galatians. Galatians tells us how to live. And Hebrews is the book of faith. That's one of the reasons why I believe that Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. Because there are clues within that would point to that. And now, it's time to finish. So, we got through verse 18. I didn't think you were going to make it. To verse 18. Anybody have a burning desire to pray us out? Then I will. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your grace and for your love. Lord, I thank you that you've given us this time, this Tuesday evening, to come together as a body of believers, Father, as a community of your children, Lord, to sit at your feet and to learn of you. Father, it is my prayer that these truths would take root in us, Lord. And they would result in obedience to you, shown, Lord, by loving each other and by loving you. Father, I pray, I lift up, Lord, the desires of each person's heart here. Lord, you know what those things are. I pray that you would work those things out for your good, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Romans 1.
Sorry, God. I can't do this, but you walked in. I had to say that. Sorry.
My sister.